mornings. Good morning, Seaside. I'm Robin Holt. I'm a practitioner and a ministerial student here at Seaside. And firstly, what I'd like to do is introduce you to the practitioner who will be holding the light for our service today, and that is Bella Verita. Love those shoes. Okay. So firstly, I'd like to call up Karen Koblenz, who's going to talk to you about an event next weekend to do with emergency preparedness.
Good morning. Well, Christian always says, trust in God and tie up your camel. So recent events of the world have provided us as an opportunity to understand emergencies do occur. We have Japan and Ecuador. So what I'd like to remind you is we have an event coming at the Street Fair, Emergency Preparedness, so that you can see it. There'll be education as to how you can prepare for it. Seaside is proud to sponsor, along with SEDEMA, which if you check your program, you'll see that Reverend Christian is now president. We invite you to come, stop off, get yourself prepared. It's free. And we're asking for food donations so that we can be prepared not only with our information, but with food. So please come play with us, get the information, and just know that your donation is very important. If you can't make it to the street fair, I'll be in the back. You can bring food or just ask me how you can participate. Because without you, some people will go hungry. Thank you.
And now I'd like to call up to the platform our board president, Rick Merica, and he's going to introduce a new board member to you.
Good morning, everyone. Hey, for anyone out there that doesn't know me, as Robin just said, that my name is Rick Merica. I am your current board president of the Board of Trustees. And one of the fun things that I get to do on occasion, we don't do this very often actually, but we've had a few changes on the board at Seaside. And I just want to take a few minutes and acknowledge our newest board member, Kimberly Leary. So please give her a warm welcome. There's a great little bio about Kimberly in the Inside Seaside today, which says a lot about her and who she is and some of the few things that she's accomplished in life so far. I know that here at Seaside, she's been on board for about a month and is already involved in the Van Prague celebration, and I think she's already gotten engaged in youth and family because Kimberly has a young daughter. So I think we can expect great things. So if you see her in the sanctuary, please just say hi and welcome her and make her feel welcome to the Seaside community. Kimberly, you want to say a couple?
Hi, everybody. It's a pleasure to be here, and I'm really excited to be the newest board member. I'm incredibly passionate about my spiritual life and my family's spiritual life, so I'm really excited to help grow Seaside, especially in the young family arena. So thank you for having me.
I'm sure you're all aware that the big event coming up at Seaside is the James Van Prague event on May the 27th. There will be a planning meeting today in the Emerson Room at 12:30. And we also would like you to share the information via our Facebook page. And Marv has got some, this is how you would do it. And if you are interested in doing that, the steps are written on a sheet of paper in the back of the family room at the ticket table that they're selling for the James Van Prague. So we certainly would like you to get the word out as much as possible. The VIP tickets are sold out, but there are still plenty of general admission tickets available for that event on May the 27th. The other thing happening today after our service is there's choir rehearsal at 12:45 in the Rose Room. Upcoming events, next Friday night, Kelly Sorensen and the Seaside Sisters will be hosting a Earth Day blessing and fire circle out here in the Meditation Celebration Garden from 6 till 8 p.m. and it is free. Also, the Seaside Sisters and Kelly are hosting the film that is being shown on May the 5th called This Changes Everything, and you are more than welcome to come along to that as well. A couple of upcoming workshops, The Art of Relaxation, Doodle Your Way to Healing, starts on the 3rd of May. The Millionaire Mind with Reverend Laurie Mack on the 9th of May, and the 21-Day Cleanse with Kelly Jean Demeyer on the 12th of May. Also, next Sunday will be a teen beach barbecue at Moonlight Beach, starts at 4 o'clock, that's Sunday, April the 24th, and that's for teens and preteens, 10 years and older. Bring your families, or if you're just young at heart and you feel like you're a teen, show up and enjoy a nice beach barbecue next Sunday at 4 o'clock. Okay, so what I'd like you to do right now is all please stand and greet your neighbor.
For the congregational song. I know you all know this one.
Yeah. God is my source. God is my power. God gives me everything I need. So I give thanks for all my blessings. God gives me everything I need.
Joy is my source.
Joy is my source. Joy is my power. Joy gives me everything I need. So I give thanks, yeah, for all my blessings. Joy gives me everything I need. Love. Love is my source. Oh, yeah. Love is my power. Love gives me everything I need. So I give thanks for all my blessings. Love gives me everything I need.
Come on, Bob and the Seaside Band.
That's Bob on the sax. Come on, Max. Give him a little bit on the piano. Work that bozo.
What a joy it is to be here with you on this fabulous day. It is Earth Day celebration in San Diego, though Earth Day is on Friday the 22nd. Balboa Park is filled with the throngs of individuals today celebrating this Earth and this planet that we are on, and so Seaside is in alignment with that. Usually I'm wearing green on Earth Day, but I thought I'd go for the color of the sky today and go with blue. I like it. Hey, remember to take out your cell phones, check in with your Facebook or wherever it is. Let people know you are here. It is rocking out. That you can even come to Seaside and sit in our cafe setting in the back around the tables, drink coffee, and sip your coffee listening to the wonderful music and message that is going on. For it's truly a place of love. It is a community of caring without judgment, celebrating your life. And wherever you may be on your spiritual path, know that you are welcome at Seaside. It is a magical place where we remember the presence of God first, always. And so to take us to that deeper place here this morning is a wonderful spiritual practitioner, a master practitioner at Seaside, and that is Kathy Bacay.
Good morning. So let's just close our eyes and please join me in the stillness. And through this divine stillness, I know God is in the house. I know that God is in every nook and cranny here at Seaside Center for Spiritual Living. And I know that God is in each heart here. I know God is and lives as my life and through each heart here. In this sacred space that is Earth. And I bless Seaside, coming from this power that I know that no matter where I am, what state I'm in, whether it's sadness or joyousness or happiness, that I am in the stillness, that God is right here. And so through this truth, I bless the service, I bless each heart, and know that we are so blessed to be here on this glorious morning. And so I know that with each blessing, that goodness and gladness and the grace of God lives through everyone and through all things.
Thank you, Practitioner Kathy Bacay, for starting us so beautifully and reminding us that God is in every nook and cranny here at Seaside, and I would add in every one and zero as it goes out, as this service goes out over to the internet for those of you who are watching us online. And thank you so much, Rebecca Jade, for reminding us that that love is watching, that is flowing over us. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Good morning. I'm Reverend Christina Tillotson, and it's my honor to welcome you to Seaside today, especially if you're new to Seaside. We honor you, whatever path you're on or not on. Thank you for being here and sharing your light and your love with us today. We have a special gift for you, and on the table right outside the back door, it has an envelope with some gifts from the bookstore and some information about us that really tells about our community, which is part of the larger Centers for Spiritual Living community, which is a worldwide organization whose vision is to awaken humanity to its spiritual magnificence for a world that works for everyone. And on this Earth Week, a world that works for everyone includes this beautiful Mother Earth that we are on, and everything on it, whether it's a rock or a mineral or a plant or an animal, whatever it is, it includes all of that. So thank you so, so, so much for being here today. Here at Seaside, we teach a philosophy and a faith and a way of life called the science of mind that takes all of the ancient and modern wisdom of the world from science and religion and philosophy and psychology and puts it together in a philosophy and a faith and a way of life that not only allows you to transform your own life, but allows us to be part of transforming the world. So if you can align with that, you are in the right place. So thank you so much for being here today. Today's reading is from Dr. Christian's Joyous Abundance Journal. And when I read this, I got God bumps. And it's about heaven with eyes wide open. And as I'm reading this, I invite you to think of allowing that heaven to be part of this amazing, amazing, beautiful earth as we open our eyes to see this beautiful earth and take care of it in this Earth Week. Of course, I wish every week were Earth Week. My soul can find no stairway to heaven unless it be through Earth's loveliness. As you develop your meditation skills through regular practice, you get to the point where some steps to a clearer connection are no longer necessary to reach those higher states of awareness. Whereas once you had to close your eyes to shut out distractions, you can now keep your eyes wide open and tap into the awareness beyond form and see as spirit sees. Since form follows consciousness and heaven is a state of consciousness, it seems logical that heaven can find its way into your awareness, demonstrating as your life now. You don't have to wait for some far-off distance, time, or place to be in heaven. Why would you need to close your eyes to enter heaven if you realize you're already in the midst of it? You can choose to be in heaven, or you can choose to point all the ways you're not. Either way, the choice is yours. So let's take these ideas into our form of affirmative prayer. So just going within to that place where I know there is only one. There is only one, that one power, that one presence, that one creative force throughout this universe and all universes that I call God. Doesn't matter what it's called, but it is that the energy that is continuing creating people and beings and atoms and plants and animals and universes out of itself every second of every sacred day. There's no nook or cranny in all universes where God is not, because it's all one. It is all that light and that love of spirit. And I know that I am one of that, perfect expression of that light and that love and that creativity of spirit, as is everyone here and everyone within the sound of my voice. Each one here, each beautiful spirit here, is the perfect expression of the light and the love and the wisdom as spirit expressing right here and right now on this beautiful, beautiful planet Earth, in this sacred time and place, in this spiritual community. And so I am knowing for this sacred time together that heaven on earth in allowing each one here to honor this beautiful earth and take care of her is absolutely embodied out of this sacred time together. Absolutely knowing that the choices that are made in allowing each one to reveal heaven on earth, those choices are also choices about how to conserve and how to honor this amazing earth that we have the privilege of being on right here and right now. And so I just absolutely know that out of this sacred time together, that light and that love of spirit just flows through each one here, inspiring whatever actions need to be taken to allow this earth to continue to evolve into greater and greater consciousness of everyone on it. And I am just so, so grateful for this sacred time together, for those choices that each one here is inspired to make in taking care of our beautiful brother, beautiful Mother Earth, as I release this word to the law, knowing that it is now done in perfect choices, in perfect love and light and wisdom. And so it is. Amen.
Good morning, Seaside. It is my honor, as it is every Sunday, to introduce our guest artists. Before I do that, I just have a quick request I wanted to throw out there. I have a very, very dear friends of mine who are looking for a temporary place to stay just because her father is going under chemotherapy treatment, so they need to be out of the house just for a short time. So if anybody has any room, let me know afterward. Just want to throw that out there. Anyway, another dear friend of mine is actually here today. I'm so glad he's here. He's going to share his beautiful gift with us. And we've worked together for many, many years. He's one of my dear friends, and I'm so glad he's here. And I hope he's been with us a couple of times. And hopefully, if you don't remember, you'll remember him after this morning. So please, without further ado, please help me welcome Ken Turner.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. Found a song that I think is always appropriate, talking about love, written by one of my favorite artists, Stevie Wonder. Love's in need of love today. Do you agree?
Yes.
I do too. Let's go. Friendly announcer, I have serious news to pass out to everybody. What I'm about to say could mean the world's disaster, could change your joy and laughter. Because
cautionary measures. If love and peace you treasure, you'll hear the words I say, that love's in need of love today. Yours in right away, yeah. Hate go around breaking up every heart. Stop, stop it please, before it goes too far. Is that love's, love's in of love today. Don't delay, signals in right away. Hate's going round, breaking up every heart. Stop, stop it please, before it goes too far. Why don't you stop it, please, before it goes too far?
Thank you so much.
And that's Ken Turner. Oh my goodness, beautiful. You and Stevie, man, that sounds great. All right, so gosh, I love Earth Day messages, because what it does for me is it takes me back to looking at all the information in regards to Earth Day and all the facts and statistics, and I never really know what's going to come out of my mouth because there's so much swirling in my head up here. But really what I wanted to do this year was not so much go on the negative side of things, though, you know, these drastic images do provoke responsiveness, which is why they're put in our faces so much, is so we can come out of our complacency or our apathy and recognize, you know, there's an issue that is going on. But this year I thought, yeah, I'd go a little gentler approach. And so what came through my mind was the line that we often hear, you know, whether it's from the indigenous people, but about, you know, what would you say to your grandchild when they ask you, what did you do to help save the planet? Wow. You know, that kind of makes one think. You know, the Native Americans, the First Nation, they talk about thinking about the ramifications seven generations out for what it is that you're doing. And so there was this video clip, couple minutes, these couple young brothers singing. I thought I'd share with you, since I'm talking about kids and grandkids, you know, the legacy we leave our kids, they're taking it in their own hands, because I don't know if they're trusting us.
We are the youth and we have come to shine the light, to show you the way you're living just ain't right. It's endangering the future that you will leave for all living things and for human beings. We're on the brink of ecological disaster. What you do today will determine our future. All generations are counting on you. Find yourself and choose the things that you do. It's time to be the change, stand for what you know is right. It's time to be the change and build a world of light. It's time to be the change and unite as one. It's time to be the change and that means everyone.
You gotta feel the change
to live the change.
You gotta share the change
to spread the change.
You gotta give the change
to be the change. So be the change.
see the change.
Real change starts from deep down inside.
Take a look at yourself, we are not divided.
Listen to your heart and see what is real.
The oneness of the earth is what you will feel. Breathe in deep and let beliefs go. Be the truth, cause you know you reap what you sow. The society's bonds that have captured your fall. Open your heart and hear our generation's call. It's time to be the change, stand for what you know is right. It's time to be the change and build a world of light. It's time to be the change and unite as one. It's time to be the change and that means everyone.
You gotta feel the change
to live the change.
You gotta share the change
to spread the change.
You gotta give the change
to be the change. So be the change, so be the change.
Don't let society's ways drive you no more. Break down the lock and open a different door. Step out of the cage from where you have been caught. Remember the truth that you have forgot.
We become the change that we want to see. A world's gonna be the way we want it to be. We are all connected by the same thread. What we do to each other, we do to the web. It's time to be the change, stand for what you know is right. It's time to be the change and build a world of light. It's time to be the change and unite as one. It's time to be the change that means everyone.
You gotta feel the change
to live the change.
You gotta share the change
to spread the change.
You gotta give the change
to be the change. So be the change, so be the change.
Who is the change?
We are the change.
Who brings the change?
We bring the change.
Who is the change?
We are the change.
Who brings the change?
We bring the change.
Who is the change?
We are the change.
Who brings the change?
We bring the change.
Who is the change?
We are the change. We are the change. We are the change.
And so I want you to know those two young brothers are choosing to be the change. You may say they're little, and what can they do? They're taking our government to the courts to say, what are you doing to our environment? You are ruining and decimating our future here on the planet. You don't have any right to do that. And so these kids are being the change. You got these little guys just saying, hey, if you adults aren't going to take care of it, we need to call the question for us to take a look at it. And so what I want us to recognize is there is change that's going on our planet right now. There is this emergence that is taking place, a renaissance, if you would, of the mystical teachings that are profound. And it is just amazing, the correlation by how the planet is calling for its attention or being brought back into balance, and the mystical rising through the wonderful accessibility that is now brought to us through technology, through the books and through the reading, whether it is, you know, the ecstatic kind of blood-soaked Christianity mysticism, if you want that, or if you want a little bit more somber, sober Buddhism that has you contemplating, but if it's missing the impersonal divinity aspect of things, you could always go into the fiery waters of Hinduism and that devotional approach, or you can go for the indigenous approach of the Hopis or of the Aborigines of Australia or the Taoists or the Confucius or the depths of the Kabbalah or the wonderful just passionate expression of the Sufism, which is the mystical side of the Islam. And if the religious approach doesn't excite you, you can go with the body approach, whether it's through meditation or yoga or Reiki, or the list goes on. I want you to get there is something, a renaissance of a connectedness, of a oneness with life that's taking place on our planet. And what it is inviting me or us to do is to come into alignment with a higher perspective and observation, say, what are you doing here? You know, maybe it has gotten to the point where something needs to change, or as Naomi Klein in her book says, everything has got to change. We're doing a documentary in a couple weeks about from her, everything has got to change. Something or everything has got to change for us to continue. But what I want is to get things are changing. Yes, I mean, people are thinking, oh, this is terrible, it's the end of the world, there's nothing I can do. Don't tell those little kids there's nothing you can do. They're taking on the biggies. There are things we can do. Paul Hawkins, he wrote a book called Blessed Unrest. And what he did is he identified different groups around the planet that are getting socially active to make a difference in the world. to make a difference in people's lives, to make a difference on the planet. And he started to list them. And you may have seen this list because it's been, or some of the list, because it's been going around for some time and at conferences on global change and things like that. They'll start running the list at the beginning of the conference and it'll name the nonprofit, the organization. And there are between 1 and 2 million organizations on this list that are going on the planet right now. And if you were to watch the whole list, it takes days or even weeks to go through 1 million, 2 million different organizations. So what I want us to get is there's something powerfully good going on the planet. And I want to share something that Paul Hawkins wrote. He said, this movement we're talking about, it claims no special powers and arises in small, discreet ways like blades of grass after a rain. The movement grows and spreads in every city and country and involves virtually every tribe, culture, language, and religion, from the Mongolians to the Uzbeks to the Tamils. It is a composite and composition of families in India, students in Australia, farmers in France, landless in Brazil, the Baneras of Honduras, the poor of Durban, villages in Iran, indigenous tribes of Bolivia, and housewives in Japan. Its leaders are farmers, zoologists, shoemakers, and poets. This movement has three fundamental and interconnected branches. One, of social justice issues, one, environmental activism, and the third is the flight and fight of the indigenous people against corporate domination. What's going on? That's the good news I want us to understand. Because it will take all of us to shift things that are taking place. Because what's going on this planet is planetary. As the glaciers begin to melt and the earth begins to change its wobble on its axis because the disbursement of balance is changing, there's things that are going on. But I'm not going to go to talking about the decimation of rainforests and plastics in the ocean and polar bears. I've done that in the past. You know, but I want to go to a vision of possibility. Rachel Carson, you might remember her. I won't say started it, but she definitely activated the environmental movement in 1962 with her book, you know, Silent Spring, when she took on the pesticide, the DDT. She said, if we could see clearly the wonders and the reality of the universe that is about, we would lose our taste for destruction. That's the mysticism. That is the connection. That is the reality. If we could see the wonder and the beauty of spirit and life, of our interconnectedness, we would lose the taste for the exploitation. We would begin to open up to visions of possibilities and new expressions and ways of doing things. Nature's talking to us. Victor Hugo in 1840, he said that if we could just hear nature crying out, but it's sad that we don't. For man doesn't listen. It's sad that we don't listen to the cry of nature. We just don't listen. And so what does nature do? Well, just like our life, if we don't listen, it gets louder, right? The slap gets louder. It turns into the 2x4 over the head. It's the cliche. And what is nature doing? It is calling to us. Droughts on the West Coast, devastating winters to the Midwest and the East. That's just in the United States. What about the fires that decimated, you know, the rainforests in South America last year? That was whipping through Australia last year. These super storms that are devastating coastlines. The Godzilla typhoon that hit Southeast Asia last year, wiping out coastlines and communities and farms, and those individuals that had the family farms don't have the resources to start over. So what happens is the corporate and those that do have funds step in and take over. Now, there's a lot of economy to be, that is benefited by storms and devastation, but there's also other ways in which we can keep circulation going on this planet. But what happens sometimes, at least for me, is that there's this collective amnesia that kind of slips in. I really don't want to look at this. It's too big. I mean, what am I going to do? You know, I'm not 14 anymore like those kids. I've got nothing to risk other than the planet. You know?
What we need to do with this amnesia is to get back in touch with nature, to see how wonderful and magnificent it is. I mean, I've got friends that say the closest I ever get to nature is my salad at dinner, you know. Many are going through a nature deficit disorder in their life. They're just missing that kind of connection. And it's no wonder that we slip into this amnesia, because it is so big, it is so ominous. And then I come back, I wake up, it's Earth Day, I get excited. San Diego's going off in Balboa Park. We got EcoFest coming. We got the films here at Seaside. You know, the women are doing Earth Day Friday night. If you want to go, you know, drum and be around the fire circle, it's available to you for that. But I'll tell you what, we've got to stay awake. We have got to stay conscious, because there is a large movement afoot that is heavily funded by the big corporations called the Heartland Institute, that is paid significantly to debunk that there's global change going on, that climate change is going on, that they are called the counterculture to climate change. And they will tell you thousands and thousands of scientists around the globe are lying to us, that it's all a hoax. And 97% of the climate scientists will say the statistics that this institute is putting out are just not, you know, documentable. But there's this battle that is going on. And as soon as we slip into that amnesia and we begin to lose our guard and don't come from that rising emergence, the mystical, the greater possibility of the vision that we are Earth guardians, what happens is we begin to lose the stronghold or the battle that is going on. And there is a battle going on. Don't get it wrong. There is a war between the economical systems and the planetary systems. And the economical system is winning at the present time, the particular battle. And for the planetary system to emerge, we have to let go of the consuming of the resources that are on the planet. But for the economical system to emerge, we have to continue to expand. And the two just don't balance out at the present level of opportunity. As we begin to recognize, what is it else that I can do here? What can I bring to this scenario? What is it that I can begin to practice and to understand here? What is it that I need to know? How can I become a sacred activist, if you would? How can I be the place where God touches down in the midst of what's happening in this world? What is it that I need to do? Red Cloud, a Lakota shaman, medicine man, educator, he said, you know, sometimes small steps are fine into the future. And other times you got to run like a buffalo. Well, this is one of those times that we need to run like a buffalo. Because I'll tell you what, the resources upon the planet are being consumed at an exorbitant rate. And what happens when there is a voracious appetite for the resources of the planet and they start to shrink? What happens is it becomes more vicious to go and get those resources. And all of a sudden, men with guns are defending not necessarily human rights, though that's what we're told, but defending the assets of those resources that are being exploited and becoming fewer and fewer and less upon the planet. I think it's time to see in a new kind of way. What kind of legacy am I going to leave the grandchildren of this world? Well, I believe that there's a new way to see how things can happen, the way things can be done. But you've got to look. See, that is that mountaintop view, that observing perspective. I got to be willing to look. But I got to tell you, I got a lot of people that say they just avoid the news, as if avoidance is a really mature approach. Yeah. Because if you avoid, who's going to respond to what's going on in the environment? Who's going to respond to war crimes? Who is going to respond to the violations of the Constitution? You see, we're the ones. We are the ones that get to say, you know what? If things don't change, then it's going to move in the direction that the scientists are telling us. The images and the pictures that we have seen in the sci-fi movies. You know, if we do nothing, but it's time for us to run like a buffalo. Otherwise, our grandchildren are going to be spending, they say, a great majority of their time either escaping from the storms or recovering from them. There's something going on in our environment. You know, the CO2 emissions is exorbitant. You know, the increase in the weather, you know, we had the great climate conference, you know, in 02 at Rio de Janeiro and Copenhagen in 09, where, you know, all these things were said, nothing really happened. We're trusting that the last one that took place is that in France, that they will keep it below the 2 centigrade increase in the heat, because after that, supposedly, it's not a good scenario. We keep it below the 350 in the ozone layer that we have probably surpassed already. There are things that need to be done immediately, and we are capable of responding in an immediate kind of way. But we've got to believe it, because what we are is an expression of our belief, of our heart, of our soul, of our spirit. That's what we are. You know, we've been operating in this material world, but we are shifting our era from a material realm of form to one that is more energy. We're recognizing that this body is just not density and matter, but rather it's made up of atoms. Atoms are mostly space and energy. And what we are is in sync with this vibration. And so we can say, I'm not going to watch the news because it is so negative. I don't want that in my subjective. But I'll tell you what, you're this electromagnetic field that is getting bombarded with all the news that is going through the field of waves that fill this room. And if you don't believe in that kind of stuff, then what about consciousness? What is permeating the collective consciousness of the fear and the images that are bombarding us? You cannot help but to feel it. And what I want us to recognize is that we're moving into a new age, an energy age, the solar age that is out picturing in the technology, in the internet, in the computer, in the cell phones. But as wonderful that is, who you are and your soul's expression is so much more magnificent, and that is what is being called for a time such as this to come forth and to express itself in ways that are needed upon our planet. You are the one that is going to make the difference. There's an old Indian story of a beggar who's out in the streets begging, and out in the dusty roads, and one day he sees the carriage of the emperor, the king, coming down the road, and he gets all excited. He said, here it is. I'm going to receive the gifts from the richest guy around. How blessed am I? He's feeling as if he just hit the lottery. How exciting can this be? And all of a sudden, the carriage drives up. The king sets his head out the window and says, so what are you going to give me? That was his thought exactly. I was like, you're kidding me. Like, you got everything. What can I give a guy who's got everything and I got nothing? So grudgingly digs into his little bag and, you know, a couple corn kernels he chews on through the course of the day if he's hungry. He pulls out a corn kernel and gives it to the king, and the king drives off and he just couldn't believe it. And when he goes home that night and he empties his little bag and the kernels of corn and he'll go out on the floor, he notices one of them turned to gold. And it was in that moment he broke into tears, wishing he would have given it all. But you see, the challenge is we've got this childlike fantasy that there's going to be this intervention. We've just won the lottery, and everything's going to disappear instantly, and it's all going to be good now. We're the ones, just like those kids were singing. Just like Gandhi said, you've got to be the change. We're the ones who've got to start to become conscious of our consumerism, of the words we talk about, of our actions that are making a difference in this world that we walk in and on. This concrete that is covering this beautiful Mother Earth is just crying to be remembered for the essence and the life force that it is. And I hear people blatantly say, well, it's if it's alive and we're like parasites, it gets to the level of just flip us off like dogs and fleas and things. Maybe. But you know what? Do you know how horrific 7 billion crying souls of agony who have just been forcefully removed would be for the psyche to be swimming in and being in? A horrendous kind of thought. So that kind of flippant attitude that, oh yeah, that something will just come along and forget that I need to do something now. If I'm going to leave a legacy for my grandchildren, we haven't figured it out, but by God, we will. And that is the thing, by God, by that spirit, by that connection. Ernest Holmes, the founder of religious science, he says that spirit can do for us only what it can do through us. See, that's today. It's about charging you to recognize Spirit wants to move through you to make a difference. You know, go Google and find out how you can get rid of the light bulbs or do less with fuel or fill your tires, all those things I've said in the past. There are so many ways in which you can do, but you have got to be willing to do that. Because I'll tell you what, there are forces upon this planet that are making it difficult. You know, there is like religion should be bringing us together, but the fanatical fundamentalists in their religion who should be uniting are using their mystical illiteracy to separate the people. And rather than using religion to bring us together as one human family, it is creating a schism through terrorism and war that is splitting people apart. There is the media, the major media outlets who deliver just half-baked news spun to a particular perspective, filled with 24 hours of inane comedy, the pornography, the violence, the advertisements. It's just this incessant psychic rape that we have just become used to, the bombardment upon our consciousness, and if somehow we are able to survive that and not turn on the network, what our society does is it honors our hectic lifestyle, just immortalizing and celebrating the ADD kind of behavior, just saying, isn't that magnificent and wonderful that you can do so much, but you're exhausted and you don't have that time to go connect with nature, which is the very thing one needs to do to begin to be in wonder and awe of the reality of the absolute universe in which we live and move and have our being in, to recognize that presence of God. It takes time to meditate and to connect and to feel the presence in our heart and soul. Once again, things are happening on the plus side. This renaissance of mysticism I alluded to, the nonviolent kind of approach to living, the emergence or reemergence of the divine feminine that is about the caring, the nurturing, the harmony, the balance, but yet is not a pushover. Kali, the goddess and the Hindu of creation who birthed the kids, then we'll wipe them out if they get out of line. It is creation and destruction. It is showing up, the divine feminine, in medicine. It is now, a beautiful, holistic, integrated kind of medicine that is an option for us. In the corporate world, it is going from competition, domination, and to one of collaboration, cooperation, creativity. In life, it is bringing an awareness to the sacred rights of animals, that the rights of women, and the feminist movement, the progress within the gay movement, and the acceptance. There is a shift that's taking place in the psychological realms where it's the Jungian psychology, a willingness to explore the shadows and the Rogers and the client-centered therapy. It is showing up in the sciences of ecology, of neurobiology, of physics, the quantum physics. This feminine energy is rising because the patriarchal dominance of exploitation is no longer working, but it is emerging of the two that make the difference. It's not the man. It is allowing the male to be the noble protector, but it's the balance of the feminine that allows it to be on the right track. See, what's going on? There's good going on, and we have never seen the birth of a planet before, of a planetary civilization before, I'll put it that way. There's a crisis going on, but the crisis is an invocation to your sacred activism. The crisis is an opportunity for you to wake up from that amnesia and recognize that you're being called for times such as this to make a difference. Jane Goodall says, everyone makes a difference, The question is, what kind of difference do you want to make? You know, when we decided to get away from the government-funded space exploration, privatized the space exploration, and they put out a prize for the first person who could, you know, send a spaceship out into space, bring it back safely, and then send it back again and repeat it. And Bert Raton out of Mojave did a great job with that, did that, and won that prize. Well, one of the prize monies that's being put out by Richard Branson right now from his Earth Challenge, I think it's called. Great financial prize for anyone, and he's cast the call for anyone who can create the machine that will pull the CO2 out of the atmosphere. See, CO2 is accumulative. It doesn't go away for 100 or 200 years. You know, the temperature is what it is right now, but that accumulative effect we haven't even begun to realize. There needs to be something new that is done. And there was a vision that says, well, let's just figure out how to suck it out of the air. Well, a few hundred or a few thousand scientists may not be able to figure it, but all of a sudden when you put it out to the globe and there's the crowdsourcing and funding with ideas, all of a sudden you now have 7 billion people working on a divine idea that is birthing itself for a time such as this, because humanity is already made the quantum leap for its survival. And it's not going to be any different now. There are great individuals that have chosen to make a difference. Just this month, we saw Elon Musk come out with his new electric car, the Tesla. In the first week, they sold 270,000 electric cars. And someone came through the line this morning, pulled out their iPhone and said, you know what? It's now up to almost 400,000 electric cars, where the first one won't even be delivered until the fall of 2017, next year. Most of those people aren't going to see their car until 2018, and they all laid down $1,000 to get on the list. They say this will change everything in the automotive industry. These are the things that are going on right now. We have to focus on that, but we also have to focus on what it is ours to do. What is it that I can do? And what I believe right now is that it's never too late. You got that one? Because a lot of the fanatical environmentalists are telling us it's too late. I believe it is never too late. And so when my son Trevor's child takes hold of my hand and looks up to me and says, Grandpa, what did you do to save the earth? I'll be able to say, I stood courageously among the people and shared ideas and possibilities about our planet Earth for our grandchildren that may not be popular or mainstream, but I was courageous enough to say, it's never too late to make a difference, which we're all here to do. God bless you on this Earth Day. Let's keep it going as we bring Ken Turner back to our stage.
Thank you so much. I hope this song encourages you as well. Nothing but an awful song, but now I know the meaning of true love. I'm leaning on the everlasting arms. If I can see it, then I can do it. If I just believe it, there's nothing to it. I believe I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky. I think about it
fly away. I believe I can soar. See me running through that open door. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. See, I was on the verge of breaking down. Sometimes silence, it seems so very loud. There are miracles in life we must achieve. But first, I know it starts inside of me. Oh, oh, if I see it, then I can do it. If I just believe it, there's nothing to it. I believe I can fly. I believe I can touch the sky. I dream about it every night. That open door, I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. I believe I can fly. 'Cause I believe in me. Nothing to it. I believe I can fly. Yes, I believe I can touch the sky. I think about it every night, every day. Spread my wings and fly away. I believe I can soar. I see me running through that old door. I believe I can fly. Yes, I believe I can fly. I believe I can spread my wings and fly. I can fly so high. I can fly.
That is Ken Turner knocking it out of the house. Woo! How fabulous. Oh, my goodness. Woo! Boy, that's right. He is. Gosh, that song has such a warm spot in my heart. When I used to be out on tour with my book, Soar, that was the theme song that they would sing at every conference before I'd take the stage. And it's just so wonderful to hear that, Ken. Great job. Can't even begin to tell you how many things are racing through my head that I didn't say this morning. I'm keeping them back. Gosh, but that's what I know is there's always more where that came from. You know, Spirit is just amazing. And though my best story I didn't share with you, next year you got to come back. You know, it's all about the divestment of universities from the fossil fuels, and just it's just a crazy story. I'm not at that part now. Come back. Okay. Hey, this is the This is the time of our service where we unite together in our gifts, in our sharing, in our love offering. We just pause and remember how Spirit has touched our life. And remember how important it is to support what Spirit is and where it's expressed in your life and your world. And as you support Spirit's work, what you'll find is Spirit supporting your work because you're Spirit expressing. You put yourself into that wonderful flow, that wonderful circulation. You become the activity that God is having. And it is abundant, it is free, it is unlimited. And you're the one that taps that infinite place in consciousness, which is truly inexhaustible. So I invite you to listen to your heart and your soul and to give from that kind of place. Because your gift makes a difference for us to continue to be here. And so with that, I want to invite our ushers to come forward as we take our gift from our heart and our soul. I want to say thank you to this wonderful crew of ushers and greeters. Thank you to those that mail in your contributions when you can't be here on a Sunday. It is greatly appreciated, as well as those that make an annual contribution or a monthly contribution and remember us with their auto tithe. This regular kind of support makes a profound difference in our ability to move with a consistency. And so I want to share this prayer of gratitude with the most generous of spiritual communities, knowing that this truly is a blessed moment where the divine unfolds its expression in our very experience in life. For the grace of God is upon this moment, and as we begin to feel that in a greater conscious kind of way, it cannot help but to soar and return to that wonderful emanation of life itself and recognize the freedom that comes with a deep sense of peace and a deep sense of security and the realization our source isn't from the outside, people or jobs, whatever are an avenue through which the source moves through, but they are not the source. That source is infinite, and there are many streams of support into our individual life. And I know right now that as we continue to remember it, it's Spirit first always. Spirit shows up in ways that are right, real, and relevant in the monetary well as the health and relationships and work. It all is interchangeable because it is an energetic expression that you have chosen to step into with that which is near and dear. So I share this gift from the depth of my being, knowing that I cannot help but to bring back the wonderful gifts of life itself. I say thank you, Father, Mother, God, for this opportunity to pause and to remember the source that is within, that wellspring that is infinite, that is the very life essence of our individual beings. So it is. Amen. And together, let us say this affirmation of abundance, which is, Spirit continues to bless my world. Gratefully, I live as the giving expression of Spirit, opening the floodgates of the affluent flow of greater good as my life now. Thank you.
as I stand before this bounty, I can feel the love. I can just feel the outpouring, the joy, and the connectedness with the infinite source. For truly, this gift has been made in love. It is received and is handled in good stewardship and is put forth back out into the stream of life, bringing the blessings to everyone it comes in contact. Thank you, Father, Mother, God, for the deep realization and the ability to trust that realization of the infinite source, which is the very substance of our individual life and being. So with joy, we share this, and with joy, we receive from all over the world our life support. So it is. Amen.
Thank you. This is Rick Mirica,
your board president. And Rick, congratulations on our newest member, Kimberly. Hey, we are excited to be working with you. All right. Let's see. Ken, fabulous. Wonderful. Thank you for bringing your song, your soul, your spirit to Seaside. Rebecca, bless you for your wonderful orchestration of the artistic expression of Sunday mornings. And Dr. Christina, what a joy always to share a Sunday with you and match up on colors. And Matthew and Steve for giving us sound. Appreciate you guys being back there. Marv, great job. And thank you. If you want a CD of today, you can pick one up after the service. If you want where I was getting the facts today, it's from Naomi Klein's book, This Changes Everything. We're doing a screening of her movie in a couple weeks. Check that out. Those at home, Timothy, thank you for sharing it with them. We know you're there. We love you. And just thank you for your support and the blessing you are to the world and to Seaside. Take a look at your Sunday program. There's a lot going on. One of the big things going on next weekend is the street fair down in Encinitas. And the interfaith community, which I tend to be heading up these days, is doing a spot near City Hall for the street fair, which is a safety preparedness day, or actually it's 2 days. And, you know, there's fire trucks and paramedic cars for the kids to go on. There's things that can help with your safety preparedness. But it's also a drop-off point for food. We help to feed those on the low-income side of things in our town that don't have the food through the Community Resource Center. And so last year we collect, I think you said 1,600 pounds, Karen? That's 18,000 pounds. I was way off. So that's 9 tons of food. But anyway, we're down there. It really helps out our town. Another way we're helping out, something I'm excited about, my friend Ken Foster got called by the state senator of Idaho, who said he's passing a bill through the state senate. It's going through, you know, right now. And he's been working with him for several months to see if he could help create a mentoring program. What's attached to this bill is all those involved with low income receiving some of the services that come, they will be given the opportunity for mentoring. It's like you give somebody a fish, but you teach them how to fish. And so Ken has pulled together a nonprofit and is working diligently to get the technology and the mentors, and the state of Idaho is hoping that this program is such a success that it becomes a prototype for the rest of the country, that anyone who receives support will also be given the opportunity for mentoring through their time to acclimation back into a healthy way of being in society. So Ken, we're proud of that. But this Friday, the senator's here checking out your technology, and Saturday, you guys are throwing a party and celebration and a kickoff right here at Seaside. Peggy Lee is going to be singing. You got hors d'oeuvres. You're hoping to raise some funds. The senator is going to speak, and just very proud. And I just see it not only staying in the state of Idaho, but we bring it here to California and all the other states. So nice job with that. So Saturday, if you want to come to a party, good job. let's see. Friday night, the women are getting together. No cost to that. A fire ring, drumming going on. There's just all sorts of activities. Read your Sunday program. But what's most special is now is you guys. Who'd like to share with us?
Who wants to say something?
Here's a hand that's up.
Hi.
And that's why we're saving the earth.
We learned about adventures and what we can take with us on trips.
Nice, nice, nice. Anybody else? Yes.
We went and we saw a cactus and it was pointy.
Ooh, yeah, cactuses are pointy for sure. Did you guys talk about Earth Day at all today? You know, we all have that draw toward the earth. Hey, did you guys hear about just, it was in the paper this week, about Inky the octopus that was at the National Aquarium in New Zealand? Did you guys hear that? You know, they left his door or hatch a little open, and the octopus, when everybody left after hours, opened the lid of the aquarium, crawled out over the aquarium, across the floor. They could tell because it left suction cup marks all the way to, and then it pried the lid off a 6-inch drain, jumped in the drain, and went back to the ocean where it was from. We have got that pull in our soul that wants to return to nature. Do it. Don't lose sight. That wonder will help us have the vision. I invite you to join me right now in that vision of that spirit. I want to invite any of our religious science practitioners to stand and for all of us to feel that upliftment that is here when we begin to turn to that higher perspective, when we get to the mountaintop and begin to see above the confusion and the fog and the smog and the challenges and the ways of this world and reacclimate with the divine, the true nature of being, and become part of that mystical renaissance that is sweeping across this planet. There is an awakening that is going on, and I want us to be aware that are literally 1 to 2 million organizations that are stepping up for our rights, that are willing to be socially active, that remember the beauty of being in harmony and in balance with the rhythm of life. And so recognizing this power, this presence, this life force, this first cause, that which breathed us into awareness. Come back to that. Take time to meditate, to connect, remember, and feel that which is ineffable. But it's real. It's what heals. It's what transforms. I don't need to tell you what it is. No doctrine, creed. It is about your personal alignment. It's not my words. Is stepping into that frequency and that vibration of life itself that just casts off anything unlike it. That which is not part of that frequency falls away. Not violent. It cannot remain. Become part of this emerging collective consciousness. Not of the fear, but of love. It's easy to love our grandchildren and look up into our eyes. But take that love and share it in the world in which we walk. Share it with the planet. Share it at work. By all means, in your relationships. That is the healing vibration. It will change everything. Insights for transformation emerge at the personal level as well as the global level. It's never too late to know, matter where I am, God is. And all things are possible in the isness of the divine. Healing in the body, healing in finances, healing in relationships, excitement and fulfillment in career and self-expression. Healing in a balanced life so I'm not caught up in the hectic ADD approach to living, but remembering I must have time to reconnect with that true nature of being. That expresses in this beautiful Garden of Eden in which we walk. I'm grateful to know that there is an emergence of a greater spirit upon our planet at this time than the fear or the exploitation. The Divine Mother, the feminine, the blending of the masculine and the feminine is taking place. And on this Earth Day week, as celebrations go across our nation, we're filled with a sense of trust that we are birthing into a healthy way of being. I'm grateful. I'm grateful every prayer request brought to Seaside is answered, that every prayer request that we might be lifting into this vibration of consciousness at this time is answered, that a shift is going on, that the heart is lighter, the spirit is higher, and there is a real, relevant healing going on. I'm grateful. It's with a sense of gratitude and appreciation for the divine that unfolds in this moment. I say thank you, Father, Mother, God, for this moment of light and love and celebration for spirit. And so it is. Amen.
There was a time in my life I thought I had to do it all for myself. I didn't know the grace of God was sufficient. I didn't know the love of God was at hand. But now I can say, if you are discouraged, struggling just to make it through another day, you've got to let it go. And this is what you have to say. Come on, Seaside. I release and I let go. I let the Spirit run my life, and my heart is open wide. Yes, I'm only here for God. So no more struggle, no more strife. With my faith, I see the light. I am free in the Spirit. Yes, I'm only here for God. Said I release and I let go. I let the Spirit run my life, and my heart is open wide. Yes, I'm only here for God. So no more struggle, no more strife. With my faith, I see the light. I am free in the Spirit. Yes, I'm only here for God. Seaside, you know what to do. Come on.
Tell you what, before affirmation, I want to ask you 90 more seconds for your indulgence, because I want to acknowledge Jeremy, who's standing up there in the back. There, he had a wonderful art show. He had a private curator do a private art showing, big write-up in the San Diego Union, 2 weeks, and other curators are now taking his artwork across the country, and all Jeremy cares about is sharing his gift. And, you know, we got this video right here from Fox News. Check this out.
He communicates through his painting. So Abby Gibb joins us now from downtown, where his art exhibit is going to kick off tonight. What a special story.
It's an incredible story, and frankly, I feel very honored to be able to share it with all of you at home as well. Good morning to everybody. So first off, let me just get right to it. Take a look at this gorgeous art. So this young man, he's 27 years old. He's nonverbal with autism. And he communicates purely through this art. I mean, you really can feel his soul as we take you around and show you some of these different pieces. He just, by the way, believe it or not, started painting 3 years ago. Just 3 years ago. This is his mom. And Chantel, we want to tell everybody at home, because he's nonverbal and because he does have autism, he needs to really stick to his schedule, right? So this was not obviously part of the schedule. So it's not great to have him here this morning.
No. And plus, he has a job that he has to do, so he's out there doing it now.
That's fantastic. So tell me a little bit more about your son and about how he started painting and this amazing message he's giving all of us.
So about 3 years ago, he woke up with a big smile on his face, and I asked him, "Hey, Jeremy, what are you so happy about?" And he spelled out on his letterboard, "Oh, Mom, I had a great dream. I dreamt I painted your portrait. It was purple and very lively." And the next day, he had another dream about someone else in his entourage. And every day for 3 weeks, he woke up and he just kept dictating these dreams by typing on his letterboard.
Oh, so that this is a letter. I was wondering that, because if he's nonverbal, how does he communicate?
He writes on an iPad, but also on a letterboard.
Okay.
And so after 3 weeks, he woke up one day and he said, "Oh, Mom, I had a dream that I painted 10 of my paintings and I had my own art show. Could this come true?"
And it is coming true, because we're here in the East Village, which is just a few blocks from Petco Park. And this entire place is all dedicated just to Jeremy. So tonight kicks off his entire art exhibit just for him. The art is just fantastic. And it's going to be starting tonight at 6 o'clock, and it runs all the way through what time tonight?
9 o'clock.
And then for 2 more weeks?
2 more weeks.
Okay. And also, I want to tell you guys real quick, one of the things that he shared with us in this quote, I'm going to read it to you now, and you can take a look on your screen. He says, "My truly great ability is to read people's emotions and translate them in my dreams into glorious paintings, realizing their true self. My ability to paint the colors I see in my dreams is the greatest gift I have. I frankly greatly hope my paintings inspire only the good in people." Chantel, your son is amazing.
Jeremy, we are so proud of you. Great job. We love you. And let us sing together our grace song.
Wow, that's amazing.
I'm living in love. I'm living in peace. I'm living my life for what I believe. Through joys and through fears, in this world I walk, God's grace shines on me, and it shines on us all. We are living in grace. We are living in grace. We are living in grace. We're living in love. We're living in peace. United we stand as one family.
Let's keep it going through the year.